Hello, good evening to you and welcome to News 360. The Bulletin comes to you live from the News Hub here at Adisawe Kanda. I'm Natalie Ford.
My name is Alfred Okanse. Coming up in the Bulletin tonight.
News 360 headlines is brought to you by Deluxepaid,
GT Bank,
and Calipo.
The Commission would have expected Kodeo to have given the overall picture of the conduct of the polls.
Electoral Commission insists Thursday's Ayaso West Wagwan by-election was free and fair as it takes a swipe at the Coalition of Election Observers for its election report.
When it comes to unleashing violence, nobody can beat us in unleashing violence.
Meanwhile, former President John Dramani Mahama warns of violent reprisal attacks if NDC members are attacked again following shootings at Ayawaso West Wagon.
Also ahead this evening, United States government warns it will impose even harsher sanctions on Ghana if the country fails to issue necessary travel documents to its citizens set for deportation.
And in business tonight, three major companies are to lay off some 225 workers by the end of first quarter of this year. We'll bring you details.
And on the international front this evening, at least 21 people have died in one of the worst cold snaps to hit the United States Midwest in decades. Stay with us here on News 360. We've got the details of these and much more news. As always, you could watch us on 3news.com all across the world and DSTV channel 279.
Right on. We're going to our first story this evening, and that indeed has been the focus over the last, 48 hours. The Electoral Commission has taken a swipe at the Coalition of Domestic Election Observers, that's CODEO, for what it describes as a narrowed report issue to discredit the entire Ayawaso West Wagon polls yesterday. Chairperson of the Electoral Commission, in a spirited response to the observer group, Jen Mensa, says attempts to link the alleged violence at the Labaoleshi to the Electoral Commission is most untenable. Here's a report by Kamla Kluche.
Whilst the Commission recognizes the important role of local election observers in ensuring fairness and accountability in the electoral process, the Commission would have expected CODEO to have given the overall picture of the conduct of the polls.
But a brazen attack on CODEO, tearing down its observer report. Violent scenes were recorded at Labaoleshi polling station, resulting in the injury of some 13 persons. Many independent groups and civil society organizations have condemned the attack, which affected voting at a point in time. CODEO was swift and hard-hitting in their findings, but the Electoral Commission Chair, Jean Mensa, was blatant in her denial.
On the allegation of a shooting incident at the Labaoleshi area, the Commission rejects the attempts by the report of CODEO to link the Electoral Commission to the alleged incident at the private residence of the parliamentary candidate of the National Democratic Congress, the NDC. The Commission wishes to state that the said shooting incident did not take place in any of the polling stations in the constituencies, and therefore did not in any way disrupt the conduct of the overall poll.
She again denied there were intimidation at the polling station.
We wish to reject the assertion that the presence of an armed security, immigration and fire service officials disrupted the conduct of the polls. It is important to stress that none of the EC's security officers in any of the 137 polling stations across the constituency were armed, giving voters the free will to exercise their right to vote. Indeed, these security officers were positioned far well away from the booths and did not in any way, in the opinion of the Commission, serve as intimidation to incoming voters.
CODEO equally rejected all attacks on a police officer by a national security personnel.
The Commission's check with these election officials, that is the presiding officers at the polling stations, as well as the district electoral officer in charge of the Ayawaso West Wuogon constituency, proves contrary to Kodeo's assertion.
In the wake of these denials, the commission is on the firm belief the election was free, fair and transparent, with the results reflective of it. Komla Kluche, TV3 News, Accra.
Well, this particular position by the Electoral Commission comes exactly 24 hours after the Kodeo releases report. Albert Ahin is the national coordinator of the Commission of Domestic Action of Kodeo. He joins me on Skype. Ms. Ahin, good evening to you. Thank you very much for talking. I'm sure you've heard the describe your report as narrowed and you failed to touch on the credibility of the entire poll yesterday. And I mean, questioning the credibility of some of the things that you captured in there, including the attack you say was meted out to a policeman, a uniformed policeman, by a said national security operative. What's your response to the Electoral Commission's assertions today? Okay. I can hardly hear you. As a matter of fact, I do not know if you could speak up a bit for me. Okay. Unfortunately, there seems to be a technical hitch. We're going to get back to Mr. Albert Ahin. He is the national coordinator of the Coalition of Domestic Election Observers. Let's just stay a bit further on this. Minority in Parliament is saying they reject the outcome of what they described as a violence-ridden by-election in the Ayawaso West constituency yesterday.
According to the police, 13 people were reportedly injured following gunshots at the Laba Aleshi Presby polling station during the polls on Thursday. This compelled the opposition National Democratic Congress, NDC, to withdraw from the exercise, citing safety concerns. There have been wide condemnation by civil society groups, and the police administration has initiated a probe into the matter. Minority Leader in Parliament Haruna Idrisu says they are unable to accept the outcome of the election as one that was credible, free and fair.
For those of you who understand the use of the word free in an election, it means the outcome, the process of the election and the activity of the election must be free from fear, free from intimidation and free from violence. Yesterday's violence associated with the conduct of the elections, in our strongest view, cannot produce a member of parliament.
He has also called for the arrest of those that perpetrated the act.
We are a country governed by rule of law, and no person is above the law. You saw how helpless the security agencies themselves were when vigilante forces masquerading as party apparatchiki visited their violence. I've repeatedly said that we are very capable, very, very capable of responding to those violent threats. But we want the good of our country, we want the peace and stability of our country. We expect the security agencies, in particular the Inspector General of Police, to identify all those persons who were in the vehicle. Ours is not just to merely condemn, but to act for the identification and the punishment of those persons.
Minority spokesperson on Defense and Interior James Agalga also called for a bipartisan investigation into the matter.
We established the counter-terrorism unit of the police service.
Mm-hmm. And these
but
guys
those
are
men
there?
Do not belong to that unit. I know the commander of that unit. I know the men who belong to that unit. I know them. Those men do not belong to the counter-terrorism unit of the police service. And that is why we need to have a bipartisan investigation into this matter.
Now let's stay on this. As an inter-party coalition for national sovereignty is set to embark on a massive demonstration next week Thursday over violence that characterized the Ayawaso West Wuogon by-election. The decision, according to the group, is to caution government against any act of intimidation on Ghanaians.
The group is made up of members of opposition political parties, including the NDC, CPP, PNC and the APC. Speaking at a news conference earlier today, convener of the group and chairman of the PNC, Bernard Mona, issued a strong warning to government over Thursday's violence that marked the Ayawaso West war gone by election.
We shall issue a call to the masses of Ghanaians to join us in a protest march against the complicity of the state in the violence at Ayawaso West war gone. We fully expect that you, the IGP, will do your duty and ensure the safety of the thousands who shall march with us in defense of the Constitution of this Republic next Thursday, 7th February.
He hinted at the group's resolve to stage a massive demonstration on Thursday, February 7th to register their displeasure. According to the PNC chairman, Bernard Mona, the international community will be duly petitioned to intervene in the matter.
Our quest for justice will not end at our borders. We, the opposition, are in the process of submitting to the United Nations, the African Union, Ghana's development partners, concrete video and photographic evidence of the facts we have stated here today. Our submissions will include evidence that directly identifies several of the supposed national security operatives as personal guards of the leadership of the new Patriotic Party.
The group will be organizing a series of programs to protest.
Further on this, former President John Dramani Mahama has revealed that no political party can beat the NDC when it comes to unleashing violence. The former president was warning the leadership of the new Patriotic Party on the back of a shooting incident that affected members of the NDC at the by-election in Ayawaso West Wogon constituency on Thursday.
He was addressing party delegates on Thursday, January 31, 2019, in Adaklu, in the Volta region, during his flag bearership campaign tour. The former president did not mince words, warning that the NDC could be more violent when provoked.
When it comes to unleashing violence, nobody can beat us in unleashing violence. But if we believe that the government cannot protect our people, and we believe that the government is using its vigilante groups and illegal forces to intimidate and harass and injure our people, then we will have to advise ourselves.
The NDC withdrew all its agents at the over 100 polling stations in the Ayawaso West Wogon constituency after it announced its withdrawal from the election. The former president's comment has attracted condemnation from the Peace Council.
Let's stay a bit on this. Go on to the telephone lines now. The Commission on Human Rights and Administrative Justice, SHRAJ, has condemned in no uncertain terms act of violence leading to bodily injuries of electorates during the Ayawaso West Wogon by-election yesterday. In a media release dated February 1, the human rights body said it received news of the violence with great consternation. The body said the security arrangement put up by the Ghana Police Service was inadequate and considered the behavior of masked security personnel criminal and dastardly. The commission said the violent acts undermine the stability and peace enjoyed by the nation and enjoyed over the period and across the world, which Ghana is noted for its democratic credentials. Joseph Vital is the commissioner of the Commission on Human Rights and Administrative Justice, SHRAJ. He joins me on the telephone. Mr. Vital, thank you for your time. Good evening to you. You've heard, and watched the response of John Mahama to what happened yesterday. And this brings to mind what COP Kofi Boakye said earlier in the year, in January, during the New Year school, about if nothing is done to nip this whole vigilante groups on the back, what's going to happen in 2020? Find out your thoughts on this.
Well, thank you for giving us a platform to address this issue. Let me first of all indicate that the former president, President John Dramani Mahama, I think spoke out of frustration as a result of what happened to his party representation. I don't think, as a seasoned statesman, he would have gone to the level to which he went regarding revolutionary background of the NDC as a party and that they can meet the MPP boot for boot. I think violence is not an issue any political party should even consider because it is antithetical to the whole process of contestation for power.
No, but Mr. Utao,
that's not something we should encourage.
Absolutely. But if he even spoke out of frustration, as you say, was it right, you know, a response to what happened yesterday, considering the person involved in this matter?
Well, I don't want to justify what the former president said or did, but speaking from the perspective of what I also saw unfold, I would say, yes, to some extent, any person who has an interest in that election, who knows that that person has a good chance in any way, and that that chance has been frustrated because some hoodlums who are masked, who are not actually identified as part of the security apparatus for ensuring the protection of the right to vote of all the elected members of the Ayawaso West Wugon, would definitely speak out, especially when you see the videos and all those symbols that show intimidation, attack by people in balaclavas who are not part of the Ghana Police Service, who are not known to the police to the security apparatus. Definitely, you would speak the way he did. But I must also indicate that, I mean, we have known the former president for some time. He's a very temperate person. For him to utter those words, I can only put them down to a level of frustration that would have been based on the accumulation of the impunity of such party thuggery over time.
Zotal, I would want to thank you very much for your time this evening. Joseph Utal is the commissioner of the Commission on Human Rights and Administrative Justice. So let's go back to our earlier Skype interview with Mr. Ahin, who is the national coordinator of the Coalition of Domestic Election Observers, Kudeo. Mr. Abadayan, can you hear me now? Good evening to you. Still, unfortunately, we still seem to have a problem with it. We probably alternatively speak to him on the telephone as we go in the bulletin. But stay with us here on News 360.
Certainly, Alfred, we'll certainly get back to him. But let's turn to some other news this evening, as the United States government has warned that it will impose even harsher sanctions on Ghana if the country fails to issue the necessary travel documents to its citizens who are set for deportation. The U.S. ambassador to Ghana, Stephanie Sullivan, met the media to explain why President Trump administration has imposed non-immigrant visa restrictions on Ghana. Kwache Afre Nyama has more in the following report.
The categories of applicants to be affected are not elaborated on in the statement. Under Section 243 of the Immigration and Nationality Act, Secretary of Homeland notified Secretary of State Mike Pompeo that the government of Ghana has denied or unreasonably delayed accepting the nationals ordered removed from the United States. Again, the statement warned that Ghana faced more sanctions if the government's posture did not change. The scope of these sanctions may be expanded to a wider population. The sanctions will remain in place until Secretary of Homeland Security notifies Secretary Pompeo that cooperation on removals have improved to an acceptable level. Reports monitored said Ghana has failed to live up to its obligations under international law to accept the return of its nationals ordered removed from the United States. Indications from as far back as 2017 indicated that 7,000 Ghanaians were facing deportation. The then U.S. Ambassador to Ghana, Robert P. Jackson, said the 7,000 were guilty of various immigration offenses and had abused the terms of their visas. At the time, he said Ghanaians were at different stages of the deportation process. The government was at the time also worried about reports of the ill treatment of Ghanaians deported by the US government.
We're still live here on News 360. Let's get into our mission segment this evening. It's brought to you by Star Ghana with support from UK Aid, Danida and the European Union. Now, some members of the Ghana Society for the Socially Disadvantaged in Accra want government to conduct an assessment in the disbursement of the 3% Disability Common Fund. Now, they have accused some district assemblies of giving preferential treatment during the disbursement process. There's more in the following reports by my colleague, Sarah Parku.
The 3% share of the fund is to help the disabled live decent lives. Some members, however, do not get it, while for some members, delay in disbursement is a worry. They allege the disbursement process is not transparent and want reforms. Previously, each registered disabled person received cash. However, the assemblies under an LI now empower persons with disability by providing them with tools and other equipment in a trade or vocation of their choice. These disabled persons are now engaged in trades including bead making, dressmaking, carpentry and welding. At 3FM special edition of Community Connect at Kaneshi in Accra, some members of the Ghana Society of Physically Challenged narrated challenges associated with accessing the funds.
You've been asked to tell them what you need so that they provide you with it. And maybe you want to sell pure water. Pure water comes with a freezer, a shop, and electricity. Social welfare say we should just say we want only one thing, and it can't be done like this. When you give me a freezer and I don't know where I'm going to put the freezer, I'll end up selling the freezer and I'll spend the money.
Gladys is not alone in this difficulty. John has applied for the funds, but he is yet to receive attention.
We have continuously followed to no avail. Some are able to get every quarter. So we believe the leaders give it to their favorites.
Some disappointed members turn to other sources for support.
Here at the constituency, we seek assistance from the MP. When the funds come, a lot of people go for it.
This is contrary to guidelines for the disbursement and management of the fund. According to the guidelines, the funds are to be released to beneficiaries quarterly, not yearly. A disability activist, Joshua Makubu, a panelist, recommended a review of the disbursement process with a view to making it work for persons with disability.
We always talk about the fund not being properly disbursed, but we should ask ourselves, where has the money gone to? What impact has the previous disbursement caused? If there has not been enough or appreciable impact, what has been the challenges?
For the board chairman of the Ghana Society for the Socially Disadvantaged, Anthony Mensah, government engaging persons with disability in executing projects will sustain them.
We can do more by engaging us in other projects to make money. Money is the problem. Giving us food is not the ultimate solution.
The Accra Metropolitan Chief Executive Ni Ejesoa, a panelist, agreed the fund is inadequate and asked beneficiaries to be considerate in the items they request for.
Some of my people have applied for outboard motor from the small money. If the numbers of persons with disability are increasing and we want to even broaden the scope to cover many people that we are not identifying them, then it means that more money has to come into the system.
His assertion was countered by MP for Ukaikwe South, Ahmed Arthur, who insisted the funds are adequate for beneficiaries.
It cannot be increased now. It will be difficult. Even with the 3%, the disbursement has become a challenge. It doesn't come really on time. That is one challenge that we are having. The one that has come for the years that we have implemented it, what research have we done into it to know whether it is being disbursed properly, whether it is achieving its desired results? Possibly even 3% might be too much.
Metropolitan, municipal and district assemblies are to disburse 3% of the common fund to persons with disability. For TV3 News, Sarah Paku, Accra.
Well, certainly a pressing situation there needing urgent attention. You can get more on this on our website. It's 3news.com. That does it for our mission segment this evening. It's brought to you by Star Ghana with support from UK Aid, Danida and the European Union.
Let's find out how the weather will be throughout the night into tomorrow morning. We'll be back after the quick break with the weather updates. Do stay with us here on TV3. Hello, good evening, and welcome to the latest in business news on News 360. My name is Parkwis Yasari. Let's begin with stories within Ghana's banking industry. And the chief executive officer of Universal Merchant Bank, Johnny Wah, has stepped down from his position. It's unclear what led to his decision, but sources close to the bank have told TV3 a mutual agreement was reached for the separation. The chief operating officer, Mr. Benjamin Kwabla Amenume, is to act in his stead ahead of the appointment of a substantive CEO. Now, UMB is one of the few local banks that will benefit from the special entity known as the Ghana Amalgamated Trust, which was created to support solvent local banks. The Ghana Amalgamated Trust was set up by the government to support solvent and well-governed indigenous banks with a 2 billion cedi support to meet the capital requirement. The Agric Development Bank, ADB, the National Investment Bank, Omni Bank and BSIC, as well as Prudential Bank, are the other beneficiaries of the fund. Now, according to the Bank of Ghana, these five solvent banks were unable to meet the Bank of Ghana's minimum capital requirement of 400 million cedis. Mr. Johnny Wah was the chief finance officer and director of finance of GCB Bank Limited. He joined GCB from Ecobank Capital, where he was a group chief finance officer and exercised leadership over the finance functions of Ghana, Nigeria, La Côte d'Ivoire, Cameroon, Kenya and Zimbabwe. And in the last 24 hours, the bank itself has issued a statement announcing the departure of their CEO. And just a bit of the statement says, now under his leadership, the bank introduced more branches and innovative products to meet its ever-growing customer base. Now, Mr. Well has built a strong foundation for the present and future growth of UNB, and the bank will continue to execute this laudable initiatives. The board chairman of UNB, in a message to Mr. Johnny Wah, said, and I quote, "You are a strong advocate for team efforts, and over the past 4 years, we have witnessed good and positive transformation under your watch. We wish you the very best in your future endeavors." Right, so away from UMB, three major companies are to lay off 225 workers by the end of the first quarter of this year. These companies, which are Fanmilk, Guinness and Coca-Cola, complained of huge importation affecting their business. The General Secretary of the Industrial and Commercial Workers Union, Solomon Okote, who spoke exclusively to our correspondent, Donald Poku, is asking government to step in to support the companies.
The Industrial and Commercial Workers Union, ICU, is leading the negotiations for the workers. The ICU said these affected companies raised issues about huge beverage importation affecting their business.
In Nigeria and even Côte d'Ivoire, our near neighbors, you notice they don't allow importation of these second-hand goods, you know, into their country. Okay, but here, from cradle to the grave, whatever you want in that process, you'll find it. Okay, and this is also not helping us. Okay, before, when they say a mechanic shop, okay, they can remove an engine, fix it, and get it for you to go. Now, what do we see? It's tight and loose. Loose it off, grab another one, tight it there. So most of them have even now stopped thinking.
Currently, Guinness is to lay off 75 workers, Fun Milk 75 workers, and Coca-Cola 75, representing 225 workers at the end of the first quarter.
When you get to the consuming market, okay, of the provisions, then you find out that you enter the place, go to the dairy section. You find Ideal Milk, you find Carnation, you find Nunu, you find whatever, all kinds. And they come with varied pricing. Okay, so it's like you buy what you can afford. And this is what is affecting our factories.
This, the ICU said, could have dire consequences on the lives of the affected workers. It cited a research conducted by the union, which indicated that 1 out of 10 workers laid off cannot survive on the redundancy package. The General Secretary of ICU, Solomon Kote, has pleaded with government to step in and support these companies. Currently, some of the affected workers are receiving training on where to invest their redundancy package.
After getting a colossal sum about 120,000, 80,000, 70,000, we also gained to realize that most of them have also borrowed money from the bank. So the banks will take what is due them, and then zim, the money goes down. So as a national union who is so much committed to our members and rendering service even beyond, and then sometimes they hope that the pension could give them something. But if you are not yet 60 and you have to wait to get the 60th age, or what do you do to be paying to get you up to that point? Okay, that's also under long journey to go.
In 2017 and 2018, more workers were laid off across sectors of the economy. Gold Fields laid off 1,500 workers, while the Consolidated Bank also asked 1,700 workers to go home. Companies such as UT and Capital Banks also laid off 960 workers.
All right, so we've done banking, we've done labor. Let's find out what's happening in the telecoms industry, because Vodafone Ghana has launched the Vodafone Express Wi-Fi by Facebook in communities with poor internet connection across the country. Express Wi-Fi is a package that enables users to access fast and affordable Wi-Fi services at hotspots spread across their communities.
The introduction of Vodafone Express Wi-Fi by Facebook is part of moves by the telecommunication giant to provide unlimited access to internet for their customers. The technology is available on Wi-Fi-enabled devices and customers who need to connect to any retail hotspots within their community. Customers can also purchase Express Wi-Fi data from branded retailers in their community. First-timers will enjoy a jumpstart data of 100 megabytes and can purchase data for as low as 1 cedi.
What we are starting here today, which is called Vodafone Express Wi-Fi by Facebook, is really our commitment to say we want everyone in Ghana to be connected in a digital world. We do not want to leave anyone behind.
CEO of Vodafone Ghana, Yolanda Cuba, assured of the affordability of the package.
You put in your number, you get a code, and you're on Express Wi-Fi. That's how simple it is. For example, 1 gig is for a week is 5 cedis. And it can go as little as one Ghana cedis for 100 MB.
Deputy Minister of Communication Ni Odota Esoa was optimistic this will contribute to government's agenda of digitizing the economy.
To encourage the private sector people to complement the government digitalization efforts to ensure that we bring connectivity to the unserved areas and to communities which are, as it were, excluded in this digital revolution. Creates vendors, creates businesses. It's a step in the right direction.
The service, which is a partnership between Vodafone and Facebook, is deployed in India, Kenya, Indonesia, Nigeria globally, and in Ghana communities such as Nima, Jamestown, Kanda Pig Farm, among others, are expected to enjoy the service. The launch was done concurrently across other parts of the country.
Staying in the financial industry, Bond Savings and Loans Company has opened a new branch at East Legon in Accra. The move is intended to bring banking closer to potential customers within the catchment area.
Bond commenced business as a finance house in 2008 and moved on to savings and loans in 2014. The new branch is located on the Lagos Avenue. Head of Marketing Wanzim Wusa Manga said the company specializes in the provision of financing solutions that best serve the exact needs of clients.
This is strategically positioned to serve the East Legon and its environs. All the customers of Bond and all our prospective customers who have been wanting to get closer, but maybe the branch is not so close to them. Now we have brought one closer to them.
Branch manager Nana Pukuya Owusu Fianku noted the standard offerings of the company are always customized to address peculiar challenges.
We are responsive and we pride ourselves on quality customer service. So when you come in, within the next minute or two, we expect to serve you, attend to your needs, to give you what you want.
Some customers were rewarded in the final Bond Asetinapa Reloaded promotion. All customers had to do was to transact business on their accounts from June 31 to December last year. The brand manager at Tema assured customers the company will continue to provide innovative products and services.
What we sought to do was to reward our loyal customers within the SME and retail space. Those who have done business over us, who have run their accounts quite well with us over a certain period of time.
Some of the winners of the Asetinapa Reloaded promo shared their excitement.
I didn't know there was a promo ongoing. So when I had the call, I thought it was a prank. Being in this position, I say it to be real.
Though I know they are saving a loan company, I can say their service is excellent compared to the other banks.
Their charges at the end of the month is good. Customer service is also good.
Bond won the CIMG Savings and Loans Company of the Year in 2016 and 2017.
All right, you're still watching the business report on News 360. We return to our earlier story about the stepping down of the chief executive officer of Universal Merchant Bank, Mr. John Iwa, and the company that UMB has issued a statement. And essentially, it says that after 4 years of dedicated and growth-oriented service to the bank, the board of UMB announced the departure of the chief executive officer, Mr. John Iwa. Now, John Iwa joined UMB and has over the years initiated and championed successful strategies with the private sector, as well as partnered the public sector on initiatives for the development of the country. Now, some of the projects include the launch of the UMB PPP Center and the growth of the small and medium scale enterprises in Ghana through the UMB Center for Businesses. Under his leadership, the bank introduced more branches and innovative products to meet its ever-growing customer base. Mr. Iwa has built a strong foundation for the present and future growth of UMB and the bank and will continue to execute these laudable initiatives. The board chairman of the UMB, in a message to Mr. Iwa, essentially said, "You are a strong advocate for team efforts, and over the past 4 years, we've witnessed good and positive transformation under your watch. We wish you the very best in your future endeavors." All right, so that's all for the business news on News 360. My name is Parkwis Yesari. For more business news stories, do log on to our website, www.3news.com.
News with Ghana's Most Beautiful and Miriam Osei Ajuman. Reigning queen of Ghana's Most Beautiful, Abena, and her two deputies paid a courtesy call on GTP to show their appreciation to the brand for their support during the pageant. GTP took the advantage of a queen's visit to redeem their pledge to the queens.
Nobody contests Ghana culture the best. Ghana's most beautiful.
Yeah. Known as Abena, the reigning queen beat four other contestants in the just-ended Ghana's Most Beautiful pageant. In addition to the brand new car, 10,000 cedis cash and the prestigious crown, there's also a whole year's supply of GTP fabrics for Abena. The first runner-up, Ohema, is also entitled to 6 months' supply of GTP fabric, whilst Wekia get to walk away with 3 months as the second runner-up. At a short welcome ceremony held at the premises of GTP, Managing Director Eric Van der Sijg pledged to sustain the welcoming relationship between the two brands.
I think really that Ghana's Most Beautiful fits very nicely with our GTP. So we've done it already quite a number of years, and I hope we can continue. And I also hope that you, as let's say 2018 Ghana's Most Beautiful, and also the 2019 Ghana Most Beautiful Ladies are going to be good ambassadors again for our GTP brand.
The affable queens expressed gratitude for the kind gesture.
Yes, we wear Ghana to put our Ghanaian fashion on the global market. However, we are very thankful and grateful. That's why we are here today, to say a big thank you for your support in last year's Ghana's Most Beautiful.
After all the formalities, Marketing Manager Steven Bedu led the queens through various departments and levels of producing the timeless GTP fabrics.
The lights, they were never new by new back home. What he felt, they were never new by new back home. Cause this is the life, they were never new by new back home. What he felt, they were never new by new back home. Cause this is the life.
At the packaging and labeling department, they were engaged in some activities.
Well, it has been a lesson to be learned, knowing how young men and women in our country are so creative to produce quality designs for us to wear Ghana. We are so proud of our people, we are so proud of GTP. We tell them to continue producing quality fabrics for us, and we shall wear Ghana and promote Ghana to the world.
For the whole year, the culture ambassadors will turn up at every invited occasion in beautiful GTP fabric.
Nobody contests Ghana culture the best.
And that's the reigning queen of Ghana's Most Beautiful, Abena. Aware from that, the weekend promises to be very exciting. Your award-winning show, Music Music, will treat you to some unforgettable musical experiences. Don't miss the moment to twist, turn, and reminisce on some great high life classics as Anajaye, the hitmaker, KK Fosu, and a host of others, show-stopping artists, headline tomorrow's show.
The enviable stage of TV3's Music Music has seen top-notch artists rock audience to great back-to-back tunes. The show this week welcomes highlife musician KK Fosu. The Anajaye, the composer, is all set to unleash his well-known musical works. Seize the moment to reminisce on some great and irresistible classics. That's not all. On standby is the host of promising talent. Signed onto the highly spiritual music label, the new school rockers and silky voice singers Creamy, Yao Berk and King Maga will also share the stage. They express their readiness to wow the audience.
And I think it's a big platform for me. It's a rite of passage. You know, every good artist, I believe, that has to pass through it. And I'm ready for the game. So tune in this Saturday and let's make fire happen.
In growing up, I saw great people who we look up to performing on Music Music. And I feel like this is one of the biggest opportunities in my career to be here performing this Saturday. So I want you guys to come through. Let's have some serious fun because I'm going to bring on that fire.
Make a date with Music Music this and every other Saturday. Music Music, it's big.
Absolutely, Music Music definitely is a big show. You can join the studio audience at Studio B here at TV3 or watch it live on TV.
Yeah.
Hey, Natalie.
Hi, William.
Yeah, I particularly love Yao Berk.
You like, did you go over my head to talk to
her? We're having the conversation a little earlier, but yes, he's good.
Well, because, yeah, she was nodding to the music, so I thought you she might be able to relate to
she
it.
She knows how to sing the music?
Not necessarily, but she recognizes it. Oh. You were rapping before we came in. One of these days, you should have your own time of music.
Yo.
Miriam, I'm not too sure.
I'm not falling for this, guys. Thank you. My name is Alfred Okunsi.
I'm Natalie Fort. Do visit our website, 3news.com, for a lot more news. Thanks so much for watching. Have a great evening and a lovely weekend.